Cherie Shank is going to be giving a Dove Talk. She's my wife, for those of you who don't know. Also, Doug Lehman, who is an awesome man of God, and Nora Tenev as well. And then Peter Bunton is going to come up and give an update on mission. So without further ado, we're going to go right to them. Woo.
Hello, everybody. Good to see everybody in the room, but I had to give a special shout out to my peeps in South Africa. Woo! Yes, I know they're having a house party, so hello, I love you, I miss you. And also to everyone around the world who's not here with us, I just want to say we miss you, we remember you. And I wanted to specifically mention those who are in nations that are really going through trials and fiery trials. I know some nations are really suffering so much from COVID. There's political unrest, there's civil unrest, and I wanted to speak right to you if you're online today to say that we are remembering you. You might not be physically here, but you are remembered, and we're asking for God's strength for you and his mercy and his covering over your life wherever you are in the world. You're not forgotten. You are remembered by this group of people here. Amen? All right, so this is supposed to be a TED Talk, but I'm not so great at TED Talks, but I will just talk from my heart and what God has been speaking to me in the past year. If you're like me, the past year and a half has been one of the most intense, one of the most stretching, one of the most pressurizing seasons that I think I've been through since 2008. And it's not just because of COVID. I feel like as I counseled and as I've led and even in my walk before the Lord, there's been an increasing amount of pressure. And also the unique situation that COVID has happened around the world. And I've identified that while we're in a season of great shaking and a season of great pressure, there's been this tension as there's a prophetic turning of the page and there's a new season and new things of God that are being released at the very same time. So if you're listening and you felt like, man, the last year and a half, I'm just glad I can stand here and have my faith around me. But at the same time, there's just this breath and pressing of the Holy Spirit on your life. There's a calling and there's a grace of things shifting. It's the tension of that that we find ourselves in, many of us find ourselves in the last year and a half. And there's a funny thing about pressure and tension. It either can take that work of the wrestle and we can use it to allow God to make a pearl in our life. Or just all that pressure just makes a lot of gas in our life, which is not pleasant. And so what makes the difference in how we get, you can laugh at that, it's fine. How do we let God make pressurizing season and intense seasons develop us into the pearl, or the pressure develop us to be more gentle, more beautiful, and more reflective of who he is? And as I was preparing to speak to you, I kept hearing this phrase, the joy of the Lord is your strength. And when my strength has been low, I haven't always remembered to turn to the Lord, to draw for him, because there's a strength that doesn't come from circumstances that belongs to all of us as children of God. There's a strength that doesn't come from our externals. There's a strength that comes from us intentionally saying, Lord, in spite of all this, in spite of all the pressure and the loss and the challenge and the sacrifice and the commitment and the stuff that's happening in my life, despite COVID, and many people who I've been counseling with haven't just been dealing with COVID, but 2020 and the first few months of 2020 have been probably some of the most challenging of their lives, not for COVID reasons. And if that's been you, I just want to remind you, our strength doesn't come from our own capacity. It doesn't come from our ability to lead better. It doesn't come from external things. It comes from going back to the source of wells. I want to read from this from Psalm 46. It says, there is a river whose streams shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacle of the Most High. God in the midst of her, he shall not be moved. God shall help her just at the break of dawn. The nations raged. The kingdoms were moved. He uttered his voice. The earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. And that phrase, the joy of the Lord is our strength, comes from Nehemiah 8:10, where the people gathered to hear the word of the Lord read. And it says something unusual. It says that as they read the word, they wept. And that it was supposed to be a feasting time and a time of rejoicing and celebration. And as the people were going to leave from the hearing of the Word of God just so pricked their hearts. And I believe it was a move of the Spirit, but they actually told the people, they said, go and eat and drink. Don't stay in sorrow, because the joy of the Lord is your strength. A place of union and connection with God that doesn't come from external circumstances. And that is who we are as the people of God. And as Laverne so graciously reminded us today, I mean, she was like preaching so much of what God wanted me to share with you, just this encouragement that with joy, we draw waters from the well of salvation every day. That is who we are, and that is the source of our strength. John 15:5, it says this. It says, I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. All of our righteousness and all of our efforts is filthy rags if we're not drawing and abiding in him. I want to tell this funny story of my kids. I have 5 kids. On a way back to South Africa, we were on a plane. I got to say it really fast because they have this big timer here. But as we were on the plane, I don't know if you've ever been on a plane that hit a lot of turbulence. And this was scary turbulence. Like the big burly guy across the aisle was like gripping the armrests. And the cabin was silent. I mean, we were like dropping. It feels like you drop 6 feet and then you pitch to the one side and you pitch to the other. The lady in front of me was getting out the brown paper bag and turning several shades of green. And you could just feel the atmosphere in the cabin that it was a holy moment. People were just getting right with Jesus. You know, it was just that kind of a plane ride. And in that moment, in the silence, I heard this 5-year-old voice that I recognized as my daughter. And she said, Mom, loud enough for her voice to echo throughout the cabin, Mom, if you lift your hands, it's more fun. And I just want to say to all of us, the people who I have seen come through things that I think would have shaken me to the core of who I am, they have plugged into another source of revelation and grace that doesn't come from our own human ability to forgive. It doesn't come from our own wisdom in our mind. It doesn't come from the knowledge place. It comes from the place of trust like a child, where we have learned to draw strength from the source of all strength and the source of all grace. I just want to remind us of that today. If you're listening and you don't know that source of strength, and it's been a time of fear, or you lost that sense of connection with the Lord, I just want to tell you, it's so easy to reconnect with your Father. And if you don't know him, all you have to do is ask him. Just ask him and say, Lord, come into my life. I want to give my life over to you. Or, Lord, I've let the things of this world shake me to the core of who I am, and I've strayed from getting my strength from you. And the Lord will begin to restore your strength as you walk in obedience. I want to end with 3 things. At the end of 2020, I had an amazing dream where I woke up and the presence of God was still tangible over my body. And in the dream, the Lord gave me a roadmap for prayer and intercession for the next season. Because like I said, this tension, this pearl is made under pressure. It's cultivated in the wrestle. But as I woke up, I just was wrecked by the Holy Spirit. And I want to share the 3 things with you. In the dream, I saw discipleship in homes happening all over cities. In the dream, I saw a return to outreach and evangelism, just passionate, hungry, open, hungry, sharing people, hitting their cities and their neighborhoods and their streets intentionally on purpose to find someone to give a word of hope to share Jesus in a new way. And the third scene, I walked into the space, I saw many well-known leaders of streams and ministries in the room. I didn't know who was hosting the meeting. There was people there I didn't know, but it was like the altar call in the ministry had exploded throughout the building, and there was clusters of people being prayed for and being prophesied over. People were on their knees weeping before the Lord in repentance and some in intercession. There was personal ministry happening all throughout the building, but more than just the weight of this dream was the amazing weight of God's glory that resided with it. And I woke up and I think my tears was like, Lord, why did you let me experience this? Even when I come out of my sleep in such a way that I have actually tasted what this looks like, and I long for it here on the earth. And the Lord said, there's things assigned to steal your faith in these three areas. And you can either let what you see define your faith, or you can begin to stand and intercede and pray that there would be a revival in household discipleship, people going, not just on a stage, not just in a ministry, but they would be going to people's houses and actively discipling and showing people the ways of the Lord. Like it says in 2 Timothy 2:2, train faithful men and women who will train others. And do this, because this is part of God's assignment on your life, but also that there is a wave coming of in the public square, out in the highways and the byways, of God wanting to reach that one, that lost coin, that lost son, that lost sheep. And the third thing is that there's a revival and a glory coming on the house of the Lord. And I believe I didn't recognize the city in this dream, because it's for any city where the people of God respond and are obedient. And I believe I didn't recognize who was hosting the meeting, because it's for any movement and any stream and any house that wants to participate. And so that's what I have to share with you. I yield my time.
Well, good morning, Dove family. Wow, that's loud. Good morning, Dove family, here and around the world. And just want to say to my brothers and sisters in Southeast, South Central Asia, that we're just wrapping our collective arms around you. We are here together for such a time as this together. Dove family, we live in an exhausted culture. A culture that needs an alternative to itself, not an echo of itself. 35 years ago, on a warm spring day, a little warmer than today, I went with my father out to a field on our farm to plant corn. And as we went out, my father took up his seat on the tractor, and my 11-year-old self took up my seat on the back of the corn planter. And as we began to plant corn that morning, my mind started to wander, as 11-year-old minds will do, and I became enamored with a chain and a wheel that was rotating beside me. And as I became more enamored, I reached down, and I'd be kind of cool to touch that. And so I started touching it, and all of a sudden, the chain grabbed my index finger, and without thinking, I yanked as hard as I could. And when I yanked, I left a piece of my left index finger between that chain and that sprocket, or that wheel. Not sure, knowing what to do quite yet, I held up my finger to my father, and I said, "Daddy, look. Daddy, look." And as he turned around, what he saw was his 11-year-old son with a bloody finger, and every time my heart would beat, blood would spray out of it. 2,000 years ago, another father and son went out to plant. And they were going to plant a seed that would change the world. And I can almost imagine, as Jesus went through the torture before the crucifixion, as he was nailed to the cross, and the Father was looking on. And can you imagine all the holes that were in his body by this time? And every time his heart beat, his lifeblood that was for us was pulsating out through those holes. Is it any wonder the Father had to look away for a moment? Our exhausted culture continues to look at his body, now us, the church. And especially for us in the West, I think we have to confess that as our culture has looked on, it's seen a body with a lot of holes. And maybe in the last several years, there's not been a lot of blood coming out of those holes. Our culture does not need a perfect church. Our culture doesn't need a theologically correct church. In fact, our culture don't need a church that makes them feel all warm and fuzzy inside. Our culture needs a church that allows the blood of Jesus to flow in such a way that brings honesty, that brings healing, and brings hope. I am challenged by Jesus and his walk through the crucifixion. The first thing he challenged me by was his blood-soaked silence. When Jesus stood before Pilate, Pilate says in Luke, he says, don't you hear all the charges they're bringing against you? Charges of treason, charges of blasphemy, charges that you are an angry person. And it says here, Jesus made no response to those charges. A little later, as he hung on the cross, bleeding, one of the thieves crucified with him said, who do you think you are? You call yourself the Messiah. Why don't you save us while you're saving yourself? We have no record of Jesus responding at all to him. He was silent. His silence was blood-soaked. Why, church, do we feel this overwhelming need to defend ourselves when accused, rightly or wrongly? Why do we feel the need to say something all the time? Why do we even feel the need to defend Jesus? Like, it seems like he does a pretty good job of that himself to me, but yet we try to defend him. In fact, as I was thinking about this, you know, we defend many things that we accept by faith. How can you defend something you accept by faith? I'll just pick out the resurrection. I think all of us in this room and most watching online around the world believe that Jesus rose from the dead. But there are a whole lot more people around the world that believe he didn't. And so when you get into a conversation from them, how do you defend it? Well, you say, well, the Bible says so. They don't believe the Bible. They say, well, he lives inside of me and he speaks to me. Then they'll really think you're crazy, right? No, how do you defend? And we spend so much time trying to defend things that are indefensible. And I believe Jesus says, just be silent, be quiet. Proverbs 10:19 says, too much talk leads to sin. Be sensible and keep your mouth shut. Second thing I'm challenged by Jesus on the cross, I am challenged by Jesus' blood-soaked conversations. One of the conversations he had on the cross, he said to his mother, he said, woman, behold your son, speaking to the Apostle John, and then he said, son, behold your mother. I can't imagine the amount of pain that he was feeling in that moment. I can't imagine the weight of the sin. I can't imagine he had just been falsely accused and everything seemed to be going wrong. And yet in that moment, he chose to look outside of himself. Blood-soaked conversations have to be unselfish conversations. They have to get it off us. Yesterday, I was listening to a podcast, and Francis Chan says, John the Baptist said, he must increase and I must decrease. And Chan says, what we've done in the American church is we've said, I must increase so he can. We want both. And so he would say, no, we can't. We have to, if we're going to reach out and have conversations with people, we have to be willing to be completely unselfish. Another difficult conversation on the cross. Jesus says to his father, why have you abandoned me? My God, why have you forsaken me? And it never hit me till I think this Easter, a few moments later, it could have been 30 minutes, it could have been 60 minutes, we don't know. He says to that same father who he felt abandoned by, he says, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. Can you imagine the stuff going on there? Here he just felt, we read through that and don't even think about it. He just felt abandoned. God turned his back. And then he says, I'm going to commit myself to that same father. I'm going to trust in spite of. And blood-soaked conversations have lead to difficult conversations. And when I'm in the middle of a difficult conversation, when it's blood-soaked, I honor the person I'm in conversation with. I think one of the things we've lost that our culture is so desperately looking for is the ability to honor. And when I honor somebody, I give them value. And sometimes the simplest way to do that is by being willing to talk to somebody. People who I disagree with, who don't believe like I do, in many ways, they just love it if I sit down and talk to them. It gives them value. I say, you matter. I care about you. How many conversations have you had recently with those you disagree with? You see, difficult conversations carry the potential to change the world. Painless and easy conversations never change anything. The third thing I'm challenged by is Jesus' blood-soaked forgiveness. His blood-soaked forgiveness. He's on the cross, and at this point, I don't know if he can still see or not. But he's looking out, and he sees the soldiers that crucified him. He sees the religious leaders that threw him up there on the cross. He sees all these people out there, and he says, in the midst, he says, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." Can you imagine a culture that admits it has and still gets it wrong sometimes? Can you imagine that? Can you imagine a culture that chooses to listen instead of yell? Can you imagine a culture that chooses to let go of its bitterness and embrace healing? Can you imagine a culture that says, "Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing." In fact, as I was preparing for this, I realized sometimes I need to say, "Father, forgive me." Or I need to say to somebody in those difficult conversations, "Forgive me. I don't know what I'm doing. I don't know what I've done, but forgive me." We need to walk in blood-soaked forgiveness. I want to end with a few words inspired by the gospel singer Donnie McClurkin. He says, "We can't get so advanced or so progressive that we forget the blood-soaked cross of Calvary. It's the blood-soaked cross that saves. It's the blood-soaked cross that purchased our salvation. It's the power of that blood-soaked, wonderful, gory cross that allows us to become the sons and the daughters that Paul talks about in Romans 8. And I think when we are released as those sons and daughters, I just have this, our exhausted culture, there is going to be this stampede at the gates of hell. And it's not going to go from the outside in, it's going to come from the inside out. Because people want to, when they see that blood-soaked cross that we're embracing in our blood-soaked silence, our blood-soaked conversations, and in our blood-soaked forgiveness, they want that. God, grant us the serenity to accept the things we cannot change. God, grant us the courage to change the things we can. And God, give us wisdom to know the difference.
Hello, everyone. So glad to be here. I'm Nora from Bulgaria. And yoo-hoo! Hello to my Bulgarian friends who are watching online. Me and my lovely husband have an online show that deals with issues concerning marriage, relationships, and sex. And for the last 6 years, we have discussed literally thousands of questions and stories who were submitted by our viewers. We serve Bulgarians in 60 nations. We have viewers who are mainly Protestant Christians, but also we have non-Christians, we have Muslims, we have Catholic Christians, and we have Orthodox Christians. And although they all have different religious views, they all have something in common. And it's that their pursuit of happy marriage and the challenges they encounter. Our show and being senior elders at our church has helped us see firsthand the need of healthy relationships and the impact of broken marriages. This was to a big extent what brought me to Jesus. Actually, I grew up in a good non-Christian family, and I lived like everyone in the world. I believed in love, and I wanted it for my life. But as a young person, I quickly began to see many dysfunctional families. Some of them were divorced, and others stayed together, but their bad marriages were really discouraging picture for me. I didn't want to be the next statistic. I didn't want to live in a lie. I didn't want my kids, my children, to go in a dysfunctional home. I was also in a long relationship at that time, but it wasn't what I really wanted for my life. Then I found Jesus. And he showed me that that true love exists. He gave me hope that I can have a successful and functional family. Praise God, today I live in my dream. I don't have the perfect family, but it is good, it is loving, it is authentic, and I wouldn't want to live a different life. But the process to get to where I am today was not easy. I paid a high price. I went through a lot of pain. My heart and my mind were transformed. It was really hard, but absolutely worth it. Today, we live in a world of consumers. Personal happiness is the god of our culture. It's kind of ironic because reality shows us that people really don't know what can make them truly happy. We may be living in the most unhappy culture ever. Today, if something breaks, we replace it. But years ago, it wasn't that way. If something was broken, people would fix it. Sadly, our culture treats relationships like that. We treat them like items. Even in relationships, we act like consumers. If we don't like them, we replace them. We do it in the name of happiness. But ironically, this approach makes us more and more miserable. Because relationships and human hearts are not like cheap products that you can buy online, throw away and replace when they are broken. We are constantly told, you do you, take care of yourself. And look where it got us. May I suggest to you today that happiness is not the ultimate goal of marriage. The pursuit of happiness can be an idol that turns you into a miserable slave. If feeling happy is your main motivation, your life will turn into absolute destruction. Today, in such a time as this, more than ever, we need healthy marriages. We need healthy families. We need to replace our motivation for healthy marriages with something bigger than our personal feelings of happiness. The quality of our relationships determines the health of our society. The quality of our relationships determines the legacy we leave for generations after us. The quality of our relationships build the future world in which our children will live. And the quality of our marriages and our families will be the next example. The example for those coming behind us. And it will determine whether they will believe and strive for healthy relationships and marriages or not. And we cannot replace all these important issues on the altar of personal feelings of happiness. There is too much at stake. Interestingly, Jesus encourages us that whoever wants to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses it for God will actually find it. And true happiness comes when you live for something bigger than your personal gain. This is what Jesus tells us in his teachings, and this is what actually human history has proven. This is why Jesus encourages us to lay down our lives for other people, to serve others. He calls us to build godly marriage and to bring glory to him, to leave a good legacy for our children. To choose to be faithful and to stay even when it's hard, to work on our relationships instead of replacing them. Why? Because we are the salt and the light of the world. And for such a time as this, through our example, we impact people's lives, those of our children, friends, relatives, society, and even people we don't know. The good news is that as you live a godly and sacrificial life, you will become happy. That's why, if today you are not married, it is worth it to prepare for marriage. It is worth it to work on your character and to become the right person for marriage. It will cost you, but it is totally worth it. I'm a living example of that. I had to end a 4-year relationship that was about to turn into a marriage. I had to say no to desires in my life that were taking me away from God. I lost friends. I had serious clashes with my family who didn't share my beliefs. I paid a lot of sleepless nights, tears, countless of hours in prayer and studying the word, dying to myself. But I did all of this because I wanted to be resurrected in Christ with a new identity. Today, I'm blessed not only because I have feelings of happiness, which is good, but because I see how my life impacts people, generations, and society. And that's true happiness. If you are married, I hope today you will realize how significant your marriage is. It is not just about you, but for way more than just you. So if your marriage is not where you want it to be, don't accept the status quo. Don't allow yourself to be a statistic. Fight for your marriage. Fight for your love. Don't allow yourself to be distant from your spouse. Stay connected. Stay open and faithful. Kill your selfishness. Stay close to God. Work on your communication with each other. Share with each other your hearts, your thoughts, fears, and joy. Rekindle your romance. Be intentional, thoughtful. Pursue each other. Compliment each other. Surprise each other. Laugh together. Do little acts of love for each other. Enjoy each other, encourage each other, go on dates, be all in, so to say. Give your spouse your best and not just leftovers. Have no secrets. Stop comparing your spouse and your marriage to others. Make a decision that divorce is not an option. Remove the word divorce from your vocabulary. Decide ahead of time that no matter what the challenges are, your story is going to be about perseverance, faith, and commitment. Because when you do this, you are fighting for your children, you're fighting for your friends, your relatives, society, the generations, and last but not least, for the glory of the kingdom of God. Amen. You will eventually be happier. Amen. God bless you.
So I'm Peter Bunton, and we've been reflecting this year, haven't we? We've been hearing from people. It's been tough. It's been different. How do you do church? What's happening in your business? And so on. And we've had that same question in terms of world missions. What do you do when the world kind of seems like it stops? Missions is usually about going places, getting on airplanes, and then suddenly the airlines don't run the planes, and people are stuck in places, or people are trying to get to places, and they're in the wrong country, and the teams that get cancelled because they can't happen. And so it's been such an interesting year, and yet one of the themes coming through this conference is But God is still God. We're in this time he's given us. So what is he doing in this concerning missions? Next slide. What time are we living in? We've said it's been economic hardship for some people. There's been deaths and suffering. I mean, I know some people who've died. I've known people who've been very sick, and I'm sure you do. It's been an interesting time. But in the midst of this, we've seen how God gives us creativity. If we move on, some of us have had to do some Zoom church. Yes, anyone done Zoom church? And we found new ways to connect with people around the world, pray. Only nationally in South Africa, they've done, I think, about 50 different prophetic sessions online with people. Okay, we're just using the technology to see what God would have us do. We're connected in new ways with people. We're praying with people in other nations. Some of us have moved church outside at times. Okay, and not being in the buildings. God has given us creativity to move forward. And there's a few scriptures that I think are so important as we think of missions at this time. The next slide, if we can have that one up. In a time such as this, God's heart to reach all the peoples of the earth has not changed. Okay. Whatever is going on with politics and pandemics and medical things, God has not changed in his commitment. In 1 Chronicles, we read this, declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous deeds among all peoples. It doesn't say there are times when you don't do that. Okay, there aren't these times of exception when we are not to declare God's glory in the nations. Or in Psalm 67, may God be gracious to us and bless us and make his face shine on us, not just because we want the blessing. Now, the blessing's good, isn't it? But why? So that your ways may be known on the earth, your salvation among the nations. And in 2020, 2021, 2022, those truths of the scripture do not change. The circumstances, the context may change, but not the word of God. Or in Isaiah 66, this wonderful prophetic vision that we're given. And I, because of what they have planned and done, am about to come and gather the people of all nations and languages, and they will come and see my glory. So, in the midst of all the change and the confusion of things that's happened, what is not changing? What is not changing? God's commitment to reach all peoples, yes? God is working out his purposes. Jesus' resurrection has still changed the world. And the power of Christ is still within me and within you. Yes? Those things have not changed. And with it, the call of God has not changed. The call has not changed. Now, there are two aspects to call I just want to mention here for missions. One is the call that really is to all of us, to all disciples. And a scripture we know quite well in the book of Matthew 28, where Jesus says, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to follow all that I commanded you. So the call is still there to us all, but we know, of course, then specifically God calls some of us in very specific ways. We read in Acts at the church in Antioch, they were fasting, and the Holy Spirit said, set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them. And it goes on to say, so after they had fasted and prayed, they placed their hands on them and sent them off. The two of them, sent on their way by the Holy Spirit, went down to Seleucia and sailed from there to Cyprus. So the general call of God to all disciples is there to engage in missions. And then the specific word of God comes to different churches and people to engage in specific ways. Here it was going to Cyprus. For others at the time, it was different. And why? The next, I think the last scripture I have in Habakkuk. For the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. So what are some of the questions we've had in the Dove World for Missions over this last year? How can we increase the knowledge of God? How do we do it? How can we make even more disciples of Christ? What is my part in the going? The call is to us all, but what is my role? What is my part? What is your part? What is our church's part? And how can we do this when there are sometimes restrictions in place and we seem to be hindered from doing it? And a few things to report, really. God is still working around the world. There have been incredible partnerships. The next slide shows some of our friends in Canada. We want to give a shout out to our Canadian friends. They've been working with our friends in Kenya, Hope for Widows, over these last years, bringing hope to people who really need it. There have been international partnerships. They still carry on during this time. On the next slide, strategic partnerships with the unreached. We've had people pray for and send money to help work among certain least reached people groups, and lives have been changed. They haven't perhaps got on a plane, but they're still engaged with prayer and helping. We have workers that we don't really talk about publicly. On the next slide, in creative access areas, using social media, communicating who Jesus is, even in this age. And there's many individual people I could mention. I've just got here Joel and Marion there in South Africa. On this slide, working with the youth, they've had to change and adapt and just find new ways to reach the unchurched youth. And then there are many people. These are just photographs of some of the people, the missionaries who are out there. Some are kind of stuck here for another little longer till they can go. But God is calling people still to serve him among the nations. The ones you see at the moment, our Canadian friends are missionaries. We have missionaries from other continents that we really can't put up here. And as Larry said this morning, it was very interesting, the next slide. We've talked so much about 1,000 churches, and Larry said it's just the beginning. And that's true. 1,000 churches as part of the Dove part of God's kingdom is just the beginning. Many of you probably know this concept, the 1040 window. Where are the least reached peoples of the world? Well, largely in Central North Africa, Middle East, across into Asia. Okay, there are millions and millions and billions of people. So 1,000 churches is just a start when we put it in the context of the harvest field that God wants to bring in. And that does not change in this day and age. What can we do? Well, we can get involved with things like prayer. Those of you who are watching online, go to dovemission.org. Those of you in the room, you will have received this prayer guide. Next week, we're just asking, would people stop for 7 minutes each day for 7 days? And it mentions three or four different missionaries and situations to pray for. Just 7 minutes a day. If we all pray, there'll be hundreds of intercessors praying for our key workers. So go online, take this on the display table. We have more copies if you want to take some for your church. We can pray during this time. We're looking to plan for the future. It's been wonderful listening to Nora today and Daniel. And one of the things we're planning for next year on the next slide is a year of destiny in the Balkans. We want to support them and the ministry they're doing and put together a team who can go, God willing, early next year. Some of these, you know, the details will have to work out, to be based in Bulgaria, to serve the children, the youth, the community, and from there to do other outreach, going over into Greece to study New Testament letters in the places they were written to, going into some other nations in the Balkans. The website's there, come and see me at the table. We want to reach out, planning for the future, to go and support and see people come to Christ. Mission internships are beginning to be offered again for next year. Go and serve for 6 months and learn along the way. Or can we ask ourselves during this time, which least evangelized people might God put on my heart or my church's heart? What can we do? How can we give, go, pray during this season? So such a time as this, we have said. And really, the last slide is just picking up on that. Surely, this phrase, for such a time as this, must include our renewed commitment and strategy to go to the nations of the world and the least reached peoples. We have mission centers around the world. Some of the contact details are there. Contact us. We'd love to help you, work with you. There's a missions table out there with different flyers and literature. And one of the things we were able to do this year, as some of the traveling stopped, is do some writing. 24 people, really, within the Dove family, were able to write and reflect on world missions today. And so this book we've put out, and it's going to be available during the conference at the book table, but I have permission for the lunch hour only to sell this on the missions table for a reduced rate of $7. If you're online, please order it online, but here, come and see me during the lunch hour. We want to get this word out. This reflects on children and missions, special needs and missions, the role of prayer and missions, how we use social media and missions, cultural change, different aspects to prepare us to engage in a new way with the task of preaching Christ to the nations of the world. So a lot has changed this last year, but God and his call and purposes that his glory will be known among the peoples has not changed. We're praying for, he has been giving us creativity to find new ways to connect, to pray. Would you join us in praying next week? Would you buy the literature and reflect on going? Would you contact us? Would you see, God, what is my role in taking the gospel to the nations at this time? This must be part of the future of Dove. May God lead us and guide us. Amen.